Professorial Chair Lecture. Chief Justice Alexander G. Hesmundo, Supreme Court Justice Ramon Colfer Hernando, Court of Appeals Presiding Justice Remedios Salazar Fernando, Court of Tax Appeals Presiding Justice Roman Del Rosario, First Metrobank Chair, Justice 18th Metrobank Chair, Justice Apolinario Bruselas, Court of Appeals Associate Justices, Court of Tax Appeals Associate Justices, Sandigan Bayan Justice Efren de la Cruz, Chancellor Rosemarie D. Carandang, Vice Chancellor Mariano del Castillo, Executive Secretary Maria Lourdes Quijano Padilla, and the Metrobank President, Mr. Aniceto Sobrepeño. Good morning to all of you, sir and ma'am. This is Angeline Mary Kimposale of the Court of Appeals and also of the Philippine Judicial Academy's Department of Ethics and Judicial Conduct, your Master of Ceremony. To formally start our program, may we please invite everyone to please stand for the doxology to be followed by the Philippine National Anthem, both to be sung by the Supreme Court Choir. Thereafter, please remain standing for the video presentation of the Supreme Court hymn. Thank you very much to the Supreme Court Choir for the heartfelt rendition of the doxology, the Lupang Hinirang, and the Supreme Court hymn. We'd
Recording
also
in progress.
We'd like to thank the court's Public Information Office for broadcasting today's event, the 18th Metrobank Professor Foundation Professorial Chair Lecture via the Supreme Court's YouTube channel. Hello to all the participants online. And again, to those present here today, welcome po here at the Supreme Court Session Hall. On to the program proper, may we please invite Chancellor to give the welcome remarks, Chancellor of the Philippine Judicial Academy, Justice Rosemary D. Carandang. Ma'am.
Chief Justice Alexander G. Hesmundo, Associate Supreme Court Justice Ramon Paul Hernando, Associate Justice Supreme Court Henry Inting, our professorial chair holder today, Justice Apolinario Bruselas, Mr. Aniceto M. Sobrepeña, President of Metrobank Foundation, our partner in this event. Dean Carlo Vistan, Dean of the UP College of Law. Attorney Antonio Pido. PJ Remedio Salazar Fernando, and Associate Justice of the Court of Appeals. PJ Roman Del Rosario of the Court of Tax Appeals. And Associate Justices of the Court of Tax Appeals. Sandigan Justice Efren de la Cruz, Vice Chancellor of PhilJA Justice Mariano del Castillo, Executive Secretary of PhilJA Justice Malu Quijano Padilla, my PhilJA officials and employees, my co-workers in government, Ladies and gentlemen, all the guests, I welcome everyone and good morning to all of you. On December 9, 2002, the Metrodunk Foundation Incorporated, through its then president, Mr. Placido L. Mapa, and its then executive director, Mr. Aniceto Sobrepeña, now president of this foundation, entered into a memorandum agreement with the Philippine Judicial Academy to establish professorial chairs in areas of law. For the past 20 years, this joint undertaking continues to promote excellence in the judiciary through the delivery of timely and comprehensive discourses prepared by distinguished members of the judiciary and the academy. Aristotle was correct when he said that we are what we repeatedly do. Excellence then is not an act, but a habit. Today, Court of Appeals Associate Justice and Filial Judicial Conduct and Ethics Department Chair Apolinario D. Bruselas Jr., Mr. Justice Paul, will join in this illustrious group as he delivers his treatise called and entitled Revisiting the Appointment Process to the Philippine Judicial Post, Models and Standards, Practices in some states. Justice Paul's dissertation identified key practices that may help the Judicial and Bound Council fulfill its role in the selection and appointment process to judicial posts and advance judicial independence. He declared that, I quote, the judiciary and the individual judges must not only be free from any inappropriate pressure and influence from other acts, but they must also appear to be free therefrom to a reasonable observer, end of quote. The topic on judicial appointment process has likely elicited contrasting responses ranging from curiosity to anxiety. We can perhaps expect that many of our attendees, particularly those taking time out of their busy work schedule to listen virtually to the live screen, have varying degrees of interest in a discussion that directly relates to their career in the judiciary. Of course, the matter goes beyond individual interests. Today's lecture on judicial appointment process is both appropriate and necessary, highlighting as it does the Supreme Court's primary focus, strengthening the role and aligning the work of the entire judicial system to the constitutional standards of competence, integrity, probity, and independence. The subject matter is an essential one for PhilJA because at the core of the academy's legislative being is the mandate to screen appointments to judicial posts, whether original or for promotion, to ensure that the constitutional requirements of competence, integrity, probity, and independence are satisfied. Recognizing its indispensable participation in the process of selection and appointment to judicial posts, PhilJA took on the challenge for a stronger and more purposeful pre-judicature program, or what we call PJP. A lot of mindsetting and goal shifting became necessary because the original PJP that was conducted from 2000 to 2019 did not yet exclusively cater to applicants for judicial posts. It was simply designed for orientation and guidance, and thus many enrolled to earn credits for continuing education, but not really with an eye for judgeship. The PJP needed to evolve from a purely training activity to an assessment and qualifying program from an optional exercise of a desirable value to a requirement that is prior and mandatory. A major shift in the PJP's character happened last year, right after the PJP was recognized as a mandatory requirement for aspirants to judicial post. PhilJA now conducts the PJP in full alignment to the legislative intent that only participants who have completed the programs prescribed by the Academy and have satisfactorily complied with all the requirements incident thereto may be appointed or promoted to any position or vacancy in the judiciary. Needless to say, as in every matter of import, we must have deepening conversations on the selection and appointment process to judicial posts because significant changes can happen when we do. The Strategic Plan for Judicial Innovations 2022 to 2027, spearheaded by our beloved Chief Justice, identified the real singular challenge to the judiciary to improve the persistent public perception of inefficiency and corruption in the courts. Indeed, the Filipino deserve a judiciary possessed not only of competence, integrity, probity, but more importantly, of independence. Hopefully, through this knowledge sharing activity, we take another step towards making great strides to regain the public's trust and confidence in the judiciary. Before I end, I would like to express my sincere gratitude to Metrobank Foundation Incorporated, led by its president, Mr. Sobre Peña, for providing enduring assistance to PhilJA in the development and enhancement of its program in judicial education and for encouraging its core of professors to author and publish treatises introducing innovative concepts in designated areas of laws and jurisprudence. Our partnership forged on a mutual benefit that continuing quality education is at the heart of fostering excellence in the judiciary, has served as venues for the exchange of knowledge and increased awareness on Philippine law, but also have been opportunities for other sectors to give their own insights and recommendations on such legal issues. With great pleasure, I welcome you all to this event. Magandang umaga sa inyong lahat at marami pong salamat.
Thank you very much, Chancellor Carandang. Today's program is made possible with PhilJA's partner in this professorial lecture series, the Metrobank Foundation Incorporated. To give a message on behalf of Metrobank Foundation, may we please call on its president, Mr. Aniceto M. Sobre Peña, sir.
The Honorable Alexander Resmundo, Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. The Honorable Justices, and if I may be allowed to mention their names, Ramon Paul Hernando, Henry Inting, Rosemary Carandang, Remedios Fernando, Roman del Rosario, Efren de la Cruz, Apolinario Bruselas Jr., Geraldine Piel Macaraig, Mariano del Castillo, other colleagues in the Supreme Court and the Court of Appeals, colleagues from the Metrobank Group of Companies. Ladies and gentlemen, good morning. Before I finally formally deliver my message today, allow me to congratulate the entire Supreme Court, led by our dear Chief Justice, Sir Alex Resmundo, for the issuance of the landmark strategic plan for judicial innovations 2022 to 2027 last October. we were privileged to be part of the set of development partners who were invited to participate in that historic event. The Metrobank Foundation expresses its full support to the SPJI as it endeavors to create new frameworks, even as it builds on existing ones. Rest assured that you have the foundation as your partner in our long-time common aspiration for a responsive justice system. We likewise congratulate our energetic and communication-savvy Chief Justice Edmundo for placing in the top 5 best-performing government officials in a recent November survey conducted by the RP Mission and Development Foundation, Inc. Palakpakan po naman natin si Chief Justice. Definitely, your efforts, as well as those of the entire court, to make the Supreme Court transparent and within reach by the general public, have not been left unnoticed. And now for my message. Excellence is a product of purposeful examination of habits, processes, and systems, and building on what are effective. Current times demand that we remain steadfast and open to opportunities that may result to different frameworks and approaches. I'm therefore pleased to add my welcome to all of you to the 18th Metrobank Foundation Professorial Lecture, which is anchored on the same frame of mind regarding excellence. Over the decades, we have witnessed the evolution of practices in our judiciary. Today, our distinguished chairholder and seasoned professor, Court of Appeals Associate Justice Apolinario Bruselas Jr., champions the push to review our country's appointment process to judicial posts. This advocacy aims to build on the innovations of the Judicial and Bar Council towards achieving the model of an independent judiciary, which is the cornerstone of our democratic system. The entire ecosystem of the Metrobank Foundation Professorial Chair Lectures are envisioned to strengthen key professions in the areas of law, health, public service, and governance. Today's particular lecture serves as a springboard for us to promote discourse on how the system of judicial appointment can be fine-tuned to achieve the proximate of an autonomous judiciary. In his paper, Justice Bruselas notes that the paradigm shift started long ago, and this review is another defining step towards the direction of a more democratic judicial and bar council. I believe that it is noteworthy how he reminded all of us the reality that we cannot attain a perfect system since there is none, but we can certainly uphold one that demonstrates exemplary standards and advocates for utmost integrity and competence. Metrobank Foundation shares in the excitement in listening to Justice Bruselas' insights and recommendations to improve the council's practices benchmark against international standards. To Associate Justice Paul, a longtime partner and colleague, thank you for sharing your expertise and providing an avenue for fruitful and open exchanges. May your efforts yield positive outcomes in the selection process of the men and women who will sit in our various judicial posts. We thank the Chancellor, the entire team of the Philippine Judicial Academy for being an excellent partner in the delivery of these lectures, which serve as a means for capacity building and promoting excellence in legal education. Tunay pong kapartner namin kayo sa aming advokasya, ang pong tagline ng Metrobank Foundation, Filipinos, you are made to excel. May we have a meaningful discussion and thereafter make significant strides in our aspirations of delivering justice for all. Again, a pleasant morning to everyone.
Thank you very much, Mr. Sobre Peña. Before we proceed with the lecture, may we please call on Court of Appeals Justice Geraldine Fiel Macaraig, the Vice Chair of the Department of Ethics and Judicial Conduct of the PhilJA, to introduce our esteemed lecturer this morning. Ladies and gentlemen, Justice Fiel Macaraig.
The Honorable Chief Justice Alexander G. Jesmundo. The Honorable Ramon Paul Hernando. The Honorable Henry John Paul Inting. The Honorable Presiding Justice of the Court of Appeals, Remedios Salazar Fernando. The Honorable Presiding Justice of the Court of Tax Appeals, Roman Del Rosario. My colleagues in the Appellate Court, distinguished guests, Dean Carlo Vistan of the UP College of Law, Attorney Antonio Pido of the IBP, of the Integrated Bar of the Philippines. Good morning. It is my distinct honor and pleasure to introduce the Honorable Apolinario D. Bruselas Jr., holder of the Metrobank Foundation, Professorial Chair in Ethics and Judicial Conduct. Justice Paul, as we fondly call him, embodies the qualities of competence, integrity, probity, and independence, the characteristics which our Constitution requires of every member of the bench. In 2018, I was a junior member of the 9th Division, which Justice Paul then chaired. I saw for myself how he pored over our cases and sedulously studied each of our reports. Although he would give guidance on how complex issues could be addressed, he always respected his division members' independence of mind and honored collegiality. He has demonstrated his competence and diligence through the fact that he has a zero backlog of cases, a record that he has been holding for a long time. Justice Paul is the chairperson, as we all know, of the Ethics and Judicial Conduct Department of the Philippine Judicial Academy. Being his vice chair, I have seen him from up close on how he pays attention to details in the programs of the department in order to give proper direction to achieve its objectives. He envisions that each judge will personify the attributes of an ethical judge. Justice Paul's expertise is not limited to ethics and judicial conduct. Considering his vast experience, he is an expert as well in other fields of law, such that he can authoritatively speak about any legal topic. There is no question about his uprightness and integrity. Both his professional and personal lives have not been tainted by a whiff of corruption or scandal. He strongly espouses judicial independence and walks the talk. He speaks his mind and does not hesitate to go against the tide, so to speak, if he believes that he is doing the right thing. I am not in any way trying to project Justice Paul as somebody aloof and distant, but to the contrary. Despite his brilliance and accomplishments, he is so full of humility. He is warm and compassionate, as he readily lends a sympathetic ear whenever you need one. He might be deep in thought at times when we see him in the hallways of our building, but he is really approachable and also capable of engaging in mundane conversations. This morning, Justice Paul will deliver his dissertation entitled Revisiting the Appointment Process to Philippine Judicial Posts, Modes and Standards and Practices in Some States. While an iskolar ng bayan may be reputed to always challenge authority, Justice Paul Bruselas, a UP Maroon through and through, has no intention to live up to that reputation today. As he said, his purpose is just to awaken those of us who are in the system and make us see that there can be a better process in the selection and appointment of those who want to join the judiciary. Your Honors, ladies and gentlemen, the Honorable Apolinario D. Bruselas Jr.
Thank you very much, Madam Justice Geraldine Makaraing. For a while, I thought I was listening to my advanced necro service. And to top it all, when I walked into this room earlier, I saw the flowers and a picture beside it. So I thought I must be attending my... Anyway, maraming salamat po for that very generous introduction, Madam Justice Makaraing. I think you will be again my senior member this coming December 1, so twice over, double jeopardy, right? So, friends, ladies and gentlemen, your honors, lest I forget, allow me at this early juncture to express my thanks and gratitude to the Supreme Court, headed by our Chief Justice, Mr. Justice Alexander G. Edmundo, to FILJA, led by our Chancellor, Madam Justice Rosemary D. Carandang, and of course, to the Metrobank Foundation Incorporated, chaired or headed by its president, Mr. Aniceto G. Subripeña. This foundation has been with us for the last 2 decades. And without them, without the foundation, we will not be able to mount this activity today. I have been advised earlier by our master of ceremonies to keep it short because we have a time limit. I suspect that the reason for this is that because Metrobank would not want to host a lunch for the attendees. Seriously, I think they have prepared, no? They have prepared lunch for everyone, for those who are physically present. Unfortunately, for those who are online, I was told by technical that much as we would like to give you lunch, also send lunch to your residences or wherever you may be, the privacy, data privacy rules prevent the technical guys from determining your geolocation. So we cannot send lunch to you. But anyway, so to keep it short within time, no, I have already listened to our Chancellor, Mr. Subripeña, and more or less, they already gave us what the study is all about. But to walk you through this morning's event, no, allow me to state the purpose of the study. We start with why is there this study? Why are we? I remember one colleague of mine, sir. The title itself is already fraught with anxiety. Why? I think it's revisiting. It's revisiting the visit. I said no, it's not that. So anyway, first, what are the prompts of this study? First, the developments in the international community in the immediate 20 to 30 years on the issues of judicial independence and judicial appointments. That's the first consideration. Second, there has been a sufficient lapse of time to allow for ample data to be generated and from which an objective review of the process of appointments can be undertaken. Note that it has been 87 years since the 1935 Constitution, 49 years since the 73 Constitution, and 35 years since the 1987 Constitution, under which the JBC was created. And the third consideration is the intermittent remarks, comments from the public about the processes of judicial appointments. Recently, we heard the remark of former Solicitor General and Minister of Justice, Estelita Mendoza, who uttered before a Senate hearing that he would rather have a return to the 1935 Constitution. So then there's also, I remember, the 2015 proposal of the then Consultative Commission to amend the Constitution, chaired then by former Chief Justice Ricardo Puno. There was a proposal there which sought to abolish or replace JBC with a Judiciary Appointments and Disciplinary Council. So these are the considerations, Your Honor, for the study. And why is the study important? We already heard that Madam Justice Rory Carandang highlight the point. It is important because the process of appointing judges is a crucial factor that affects the principles of independence and impartiality in the judiciary. Article 10 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights views judicial independence in the context of a person's right to a fair and public hearing by an independent and impartial tribunal in the determination of his rights and obligations and of his innocence or guilt in a criminal action against him or her. Article 14.1 of the International Convention on Civil and Political Rights similarly underscores the right to a hearing before a competent, impartial, and independent judiciary. So the concept of independence is part and parcel of the core competence, the job of the judiciary, the judges. No? In Angara versus Electoral Commission, you will note that this is the case that transported to our jurisdiction, the landmark U.S. case of Marbury versus Madison, where Chief Justice John Marshall then championed judicial supremacy. Before it was unheard of, but he was the one who said that the Supreme Court is supreme more than the other branches. But we are not here to spout that. We are here simply to say that there must be co-equal, co-independent existence amongst the three branches of government. Angara says that the concept of independence of the three branches of government extends from the notion that the powers of government must be divided amongst the three branches for the purpose of ensuring that one branch does not lord it over another branch of government or over the citizenry. And therefore, to achieve this purpose, the power must be divided and wielded by co-equal, co-independent branches of government that are equally capable of independent action in exercising their respective mandates. Angara further goes on to say that lack of independence would result in the inability of one branch of government to check the arbitrary or self-interest assertions of another or others. We are talking here about the check and balances principles. No? Under the unique, no, to the judiciary, independence, impartiality, these are unique qualities to the judiciary. Why? Because judges, day in and day out, they face, they determine, they balance things. This is not something common, I mean, not required of those who are legislators or the executive. Why? Because the legislator, they have to be partial, they have to listen to their constituents to articulate their interests. So in other words, they cannot be impartial. So with the executive implements the law, executes. Naturally, they have to be an advocate of, they have to implement the law, whatever the law may be. It is only the judiciary that is uniquely conforms with this idea, the concept of independence. Of course, independence will have to be understood in two senses. There are two aspects of independence. The decisional independence, or we call individual independence, and the institutional independence. The concern of, well, these two concerns, no? These are the concerns of the appointments processes, maintaining decisional independence as well as institutional independence. Very briefly, when you talk of decisional independence, this refers to the ability of the judge to render decisions free from political or popular influence based solely on the individual facts and applicable law. On the other hand, simply put, institutional independence refers to the collective independence of the judiciary as a body. So this is what we are targeting, my colleagues, your honors. No, we are championing judicial independence, co-equal independence, co-equal with the other branches of government. We are not saying that the judiciary should be independent of or more independent than the other branches. Now, judicial appointment and independence, the UN Human Rights Committee had this to say, no? They said that the requirement of independence refers in particular to the procedure and qualifications for the appointment of judges. They say that states should take specific measures guaranteeing the independence of the judiciary, protecting judges from any form of political influence in their decision making, through the constitution or adoption of laws, establishing clear procedure and objective criteria for the appointment of the members of the judiciary. We have this already in our constitution. We have the JBC, which was created way back in 87. And that's why we are here now trying to review, revisit whether our existing JBC is still at par or at abreast with developments elsewhere. So let me take you, well, I will skip this because we all know the JBC under the constitution. We simply know that there are 7 members, 3 ex officio members. The first one being led, our Chief Justice is the chair of this JBC with 2 ex officio members, the Secretary of Justice and the a representative from Congress. And then 4 regular members, 1 coming from the IBP, 1 from the academic sector, law professors, 1 retired Supreme Court Justice Association, and 1 from the private sector. The mechanics, how they operate, you already know. Their main job is to vet judicial aspirants and recommend a list of at least 3 for every vacant judicial post. It is recommendatory from the first level court judge all the way to the Supreme Court. That's the principal function. However, there's a catch-all provision because it is under the Supreme Court as mandated by the Constitution. It can be assigned other functions by the Supreme Court. So how organized, we already know this. I just want to highlight that in Chavez and Umali, questioning the JBC's procedure at that time, these 2 cases simply say that there can only be 1 regular member, one ex officio member from the Congress, no? Because in previously, the JBC had 8 members, 1 from the Senate, 1 from the lower house. Then their attention was called by Chavez, so the Supreme Court came out and Chavez said that cannot be done. JBC said, okay, we will allow, but you'll have 1/2 vote each, although there are 2 of you. Then later on, it became alternatingly. You can have 1 full vote, but alternate 1 seat between January and June, the next one July to December. So that's how it is, no? Now, in Sereno, in De Castro versus JBC, the Supreme Court said the selection of candidates whose names will be in the list to be submitted to the president is within the discretion of the JBC. Okay. No quarrel about that. No? And in Villanueva versus JBC, Villanueva was a judge who challenged his non-inclusion. The Supreme Court said its discretion is freed from legislative, executive, or judicial intervention to ensure that the JBC is shielded from any outside pressure and improper influence. So it's what the Supreme Court said, no? Shielded. But we'll have to examine exactly the composition of our JBC, whether or not this is being met, no? But very clear, no? Met. But the way it's structured, we'll have to note that the JBC is under the supervision of the Supreme Court. It has 1 member from the Congress, and most of the other members are appointed by the president. Now, as I said, we know very well how JBC is structured. We now go, I will have to just walk you through this because, as I said earlier, I have been advised to keep it short and simple. So we'll keep it short and simple. International models. The study looked at various events, various meetings, various declarations in the past 20 or 30 years. What this group of experts, group of concerned persons, jurists, judges, lawyers, had to say. You know, they put their minds together and expressed what they believe should be a model judicial appointment process, and they all were in agreement. Also, they were in agreement that it must be done through an independent body. So what did we do in the study? We looked at the common parameters, and we found out we are going to analyze these processes through 6 parameters. If you will note on the screen, if you have the screen in front of you, on the ordinate axis, the Y axis, we have the membership, meaning to say how the council is composed, who are the members. then we have qualification. If any, what are the qualifications prescribed for the members of the council? Then we have who constitutes or appoints the council itself. And then what's the scope of their authority? Is the council able to merely recommend or does it have the power to appoint? And then as to procedure and the term. So those are the parameters that we looked into. And this will be repetitive all throughout, no? As we move from one declaration, one principle, one initiative to the other, this is what you will have, a way of a framework. The first group, we look at the judicial integrity group measures for the effective implementation of the Bangalore principles. For those of us who are not so familiar with what is this Bangalore principles, Bangalore is in India, no? This is actually is meant to be the universal declaration of the code of conduct for all judges all throughout. This is the product of a series of meetings amongst senior justices, chief justices. I recall that our own Chief Justice Davide and Chief Justice Pulo were part of this active group. And they were able to come out with a set of principles, which we now call the Bangalore Principles of Judicial Conduct, which, by the way, are the very same principles which our new code of conduct for the Philippine judiciary espoused. No? What are these? Very simply, if you'll allow me, independence. Number two, impartiality. Number three, integrity. Number four, propriety. Number five, equality. And six principles, competence and diligence. These are the very same canons of judicial conduct that we live by day in, day out. No, so that is what this Bangalore group advocated also. They wanted to go into how the process of appointments is met by member nation. No? Then we have the IBA. Minimum standards. We have the International Association of Judges, the Universal Charter of Judges, 1899. No? And you will note, as you go through the grid, that there are big portions that are unfilled. It only means to say that they have no recommendations or prescription with respect to those parameters. Now, look at International Bar Association as to membership. Now, the three. In the JIG, they say that the judicial and lay representation must be there in the membership. And it should not be dominated by political consideration. On the other hand, as to membership, the IBA says that majority from the judiciary and the legal profession. In other words, most of the members should come from the judiciary and the legal profession. Of course, it says that the executive and legislative branches may also participate. On the other hand, the last one, the Universal Charter of Judges, they prescribe that majority must be judges. With respect to non-judge members, they must represent a variety of civil society. Politicians and members of the executive legislative are prohibited. Okay? That's what they prescribe. As to qualification, only the JIG group came up with a set of qualifications. They said that at least the membership should be based on competence, experience, appreciation of the importance of a culture of independence. As to who constitutes and appoints, both JIG and the IBA are silent on this point. The charter of the judge says that the judge members themselves will elect their representatives. In other words, the members of the council should be generated by the judges themselves. They will be the ones to choose. As to scope of authority, only the IBA has an item on this, and it says that appointments must ultimately be vested in the judiciary council. Appointments by a non-judicial body may be used only in countries where judicial appointments operate satisfactorily. So there is a recommendation that the council must be the one to appoint. With respect to procedure and term, all the three are silent on this. No? Let's move on to the Montreal Declaration, Montreal in Canada, no, where they met, Mount Scopus Standards, where the meeting was held in Jerusalem, Cape Town Principles, where they met in South Africa. Again, look at the membership. Montreal Declaration says must have members of the judiciary and the legal profession. Mount Scopus standards, proper balance from each of the branches of government and the legal profession. Cape Town principles, they say that must come from the judiciary and from a range of other institutional, professional, and lay backgrounds. Let me backtrack a little bit as to membership. You will note that our JBC membership is comprised of four regular members. In the proceedings before, I think it was in one case, Justice Abad made the remark that actually you're talking about of the seven, you're talking only of one coming from Congress. All the six are eventually president appointees. But of course, the Chief Justice and ex officio chair, no? Eventually Chief Justice appoints the Chief Justice. Then the Minister of Justice, Secretary of Justice, is an appointee of the president. The four other regular members are also appointees of the president. So the remark was made, there are six, no? While in the 87 CONCOM provisions, they wanted to move away from the domination, the influence of the legislature, what happened was we emasculated the Congress and excessively put the influence on the executive. Because the executive has six members, and there's only one from Congress. That's why there was the remark that was why this case of Chavez and O'Malley, they wanted to have two. Anyway, so that's it for membership. Qualification, both Montreal and Mount Scopus, silent on that. From the Cape Town principles, it must be diverse. Membership must be diverse in terms of race, gender, professional and life experience, and other relevant considerations. So it does not matter whether or not the members are judges, etc. No? As to who constitutes or appoints, both Montreal and Mount Scopus are silent. Again, in Cape Town, the aspiration is judge members must be the one to elect or constitute the council. No? As to scope of authority, the Montreal Declaration says that, well, the executive or the legislative may participate in the process, but the final appointment decision must be made in consultation with the members of the judiciary and the legal profession, or by the council, if there is council. No? But by the way, when you talk of council here, we refer to also Judicial Appointments Commission. In some jurisdictions, basically common law jurisdictions, they are partial to the term commission. Or in civil law jurisdictions, they'd rather use that term council. So we refer to the same thing, no? Judicial Council, Judicial Commission. The Mount Scopus standards simply favors the use of council. The Cape Town principles, the council must have the power to make the decision which candidates are appointed to judicial post. And when the formal power of appointment is vested in another branch of government, even when the formal power is vested, so they are advocating that a formal appointed power can be in the executive, but the matter of actually making the selection can be by the council. As to procedure, well, the Mount Scopus standards prescribe transparent procedures and standards, considers professional qualification, integrity, ability, and efficiency. The Cape Town principles say there must be public interviews, there must be keeping of sufficient records of proceedings, there must be reviewability of decisions of legal on legal and constitutional grounds. I believe we are able to adhere to these principles. No? With respect to term, only the Cape Town prescriptions say that there must be term limits subject to security of tenure. Now let's look at Europe, not the entire Europe, no? just a few, what happened in Europe in the past 10, 20 years. Look at the membership again from the European Charter, Statute of Judges, Committee of Ministers, and the Consultative Council of European Judges opinion. As to membership, one half must be judges. No member should be appointed by a political authority. With respect to the Committee of Ministers, judges must compose not less than half of the members of the council. And then as to the opinion number 10, they say that the council must be composed of judges or mixed composition with substantial majority of judges. Non-judge members, if there be any, should come from outstanding jurists
university professors, or citizens of acknowledged status. As to qualification, the opinion number 10 says council appointments must be on the basis of competence, experience, understanding, judicial life, and culture of independence. Members should not be active politicians or members of the executive or legislative. So here there is a clear opinion that the membership should exclude politicians. As to who constitutes appoints, here again you will see across the abscissa or across the horizontal axis, there is a concurrence in their opinion that judge members must be the one to constitute the council. They themselves must elect. No? As to the scope of authority, the European Charter says that the council itself may select and appoint or propose or recommend to an appointing authority. In case there is an appointing authority, the authority can reject, but only on reasonable grounds. So that's the standard they prescribe. Council may itself appoint or recommend. If the council recommends, the appointing authority appoints, but must state rejection. The committee of ministers say that the council must have appointing power. If the formal appointing power is vested in another body, it must follow the recommendation. Then in the opinion number 10, it says that although appointment can be made by an official of the head of state, he or she must be bound by the proposal from the council. So as to procedure, the committee of ministers say there must be transparency and the presence of a mechanism to challenge a decision or the procedure under which the decision was made. With respect to the opinion number 10, appointment and selection criteria must be made accessible to the general public. Judicial review in case of abuse and exercise of the council authority. We precisely are in JBs under the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court can very well supervise JBs. The term of members, the opinion number 10 says, with term limits, subject to security of tenure. Okay, with term limits. The Magna Carta of Judges, the Venice Commission, Dublin Declaration. Again, you will note that this prescription are all saying that there must be a substantial number of judges, those who are involved in the judiciary, to comprise the council. And then, with respect to the Venice Commission, if ever there are members elected by the parliament, there must be legal qualifications. And the account must be taken of the possible conflicts of interest, no, when they are made members. Scope of authority, the Magna Carta simply says broad competencies, very vague. No? Meaning to say, the council can either make the appointment itself or make recommendations. Venice Commission says a decisive influence on the appointment of judges. These are very diplomatic statements, if you'll ask me. No? The Dublin Declaration says the government may have the final authority in the process through the recommendation of the council. If the appointing authority refuses to follow the council, it should make known such decisions and state the reason therefore. Okay. As to procedure, the Dublin Declaration says, prescribes that appointment process must be open to the public except for council deliberations. Opportunity to know why an unsuccessful candidate failed and the right to file a complaint if unfairly treated. In our jurisdiction, we have had that experience now. Now, let's look at the Commonwealth. The Commonwealth is a group of former colonies of the British Empire. No? And I'd like to highlight the fact that, well, there are Latimer principles. There was a meeting in Latimer House in Buckinghamshire, England, and they came up with these suggestions. No? But look at the Commonwealth Law Minister's Model Law. This is the only one that I have seen that traverses all the six parameters. The prescription is for 13 members, very big number of council. No? The Chief Justice as a member, then two others, then the President of the Court of Appeal, then two members, two senior judicial officers, the Chief Magistrate, then two practicing members of the legal profession, a teacher of law, and 5 lay members who are not members of the executive. This is so far the biggest number that I have seen. There are others that have as much as 20, 25 members. As to who constitutes this council, for the first 3 members, the Chief Justice designates. For the 5th one, the member is nominated by the relevant professional body. For the 6th classification, this will be nominated by the relevant body representing universities or law teachers. For the lay persons, nominated by the body representing civil societies. So you will note that this one, it prescribes a diverse set of members. As to authority, the Latimer principles say that as a rule, the council must be the appointing authority. If the appointing power is in another body, he or she must act on the recommendation of the council. The Commonwealth Law Minister's Modern Law say that the council selects applicants for appointment and advises the head of state for formal appointment. The head of state does not have the power to overrule the decision of the council. So this is puts tremendous power on the council. No? There is only a formal appointment extended. Once the council decides, it's a mere formal appointment by the head of state. As to procedure in the Commonwealth Law Minister's Modern Law, they require quorum requirement because there are 13 of them. 7 at least must be present to vote. They allow for divisions. No? As to term, the recommendation is for others, for the lay members, 4 years with 1 reappointment. In the Americas, well, Campeche Declaration, Mexico. No? And then we have the Inter-American Council on Human Rights recommendations also. Very diplomatic suggestions, substantial and representative number of judges, genuinely plural legislature, etc. As to who constitutes, look at the Inter-American Committee on Human Rights suggestion. The judges members, elected by the judges, will be the one to constitute. No? And then, as to authority, the IACHR prescribes wide discretion to extend appointments. Political organs of government must be denied direct authority. Okay? Procedure, public and transparent proceedings, fair and transparent procedure, publication of vacancy, public hearings, which we have in place, no? With our JBC. Then based on objective assessment of the merit and qualification of the candidate. As mentioned by our chancellor, recently the JBC and the FILGIA had a synergy such that the FILGIA vets initially conducts the PJP, no? In consonance with the Republic Act 8557, and then JBC now considers this list of those who have been satisfied the requirements of FILGIA. Now in Asia, we had several meetings which took place. We have the Beijing principles, the Kyiv recommendations, where there is a raging war now in Ukraine. We have the Istanbul Declaration. Again, for as to membership, they say must include representatives from the higher judiciary. So there is always a repetitive emphasis on the judiciary being represented, if not equally, amply, more than the majority. Okay. As to who constitutes and appoints, both are silent except for Kyiv recommendations. The Kyiv recommendations say that judge members must be elected by their peers, but must not be nominated by appellate court judges. I suspect that those who framed this consisted mostly of trial court judges. No? That's why the particular mention, not nominated by appellate court judges. In any event, note that this desire is to have the council membership peopled or filled up by judges, those who are involved in the profession. The Istanbul Declaration in Turkey, formerly Constantinople, the lower judiciary, as to authority, no? For lower judiciary, appointment must be made by the council. For higher judiciary, the formal intervention of the head of state is prescribed. So here, prescribes a dichotomy. For lower court judges, the judiciary can take care of its own. For higher Supreme Court, that is probably where we will need the participation of the other branch of government. Now, let's look at the practices in some states. I'm looking at my watch and I'm trying to look at our MC, who will shortly remind me that my time is up. Practices in some states, very, very briefly, what is in place in France, in Spain, and Denmark? No? In France, the membership of the council, the chair is the chief president of the Court of Cassation. The members, there are five judges members, then one public prosecutor, one counselor of state, one practicing lawyer, and six qualified prominent citizens. With respect to prominent citizens' qualification, they prescribe that they must not be members of the parliament, nor the judiciary, nor of the administration, executive. It's also a diverse group of membership. In Spain, the chair is again the president of the Supreme Court, bigger membership, 12 judges and the magistrates, four nominated by the Congress, and another four nominated by the Senate. So this model, this prescription, adheres to that model where there is a mixed composition of both of the three branches of government. Now, in Denmark, the chair is the Supreme Court judge, and the members, one high court judge, one district court judge, one lawyer, and two representatives from the public. Now, again, majority judges. As to who constitutes, in France, the judges, prosecutors are elected by their peers. Okay? In Spain, judges must be endorsed by 25 lawyers of a legally constituted judicial association. In Denmark, it is the executive, the Minister of Justice, appoints members of the council. What can they do? In France, it is still the President of the Republic who retains the final authority. The council makes recommendation concerning the appointment of the President of the Court of Appeal, the Chief Presidents of the Courts of Appeal, and the President of the High Court. Regarding the other judges, the council is only required to be consulted. In Spain, the council proposes the appointment of judges, senior judges, and magistrates of the Supreme Court, who are formally appointed by the king. The king is merely the formal appointing authority. In other words, the council itself is the one that vets, selects, and actually appoints. No? In Denmark, it's more of the executive, no? A list is submitted to the Minister of Justice, and the Minister of Justice makes all the appointments, except for the President of the Supreme Court. No. In practice, the recommendations are always followed. In Florida, it's in the U.S., no? There are 9 members of a judicial nominating commission, and these are all what? They come from the bar and the public, no? Members appointed by the bar must be actively engaged in the practice of law in that jurisdiction where the judicial post is to be filled. No? The electors must reside in the same territorial jurisdiction. The electors appointed by the... This is unique because the first six, they are elected. And once they are elected, these six will be the ones to choose the three others to compose the nine. Okay. In Mexico, the chair is the president of the Supreme Court with 6 members. Qualifications of the members, well, of course, it's ex officio for the chief, for the president, no? And then the others, the counselors appointed by the Supreme Court, must be circuit or district judges. Those are the other members. All members are subject to the same personal and professional qualifications as that of the Supreme Court. This brings to mind an incident that I encountered when I was speaking before senior judges on the canons of judicial conduct, the Bangalore principles. They remarked that the Constitution requires that aspirants to judicial post must be of proven competence, integrity, probity, and independence. They say, hey, how come there is no provision in the Constitution with respect to members of the JBC? Well, I said, well, probably with respect to those already in the judiciary, Chief Justice, we assume that they have those qualities. Maybe it's with respect to the non-jurists, the lay members, perhaps that's where we should impose the requirement. So that's that, just the remark, no, that I heard from the senior judges. As to who constitutes, well, they're elected in Florida. No? As the authority, what can the council do? In Florida, the council merely recommends the judges of the state Supreme Court. The governor is the one that appoints. No? In Mexico, there is no authority with regard to the Supreme Court. The power to appoint, appointing authority with regards to other federal judges, including circuit and district court, so lower court, the council appoints. In Dominican Republic, the council has the authority on Supreme Court appointments. It has no authority with respect to appointments through the council appointments of other judges of lower courts, because the council itself makes the appointments, no? The Supreme Court, no? To the council. Let us look at South Africa, Kenya, and South Korea. In Korea, the process is different because in Korea, all judges are appointed by the Supreme Court. There is a personal committee that recommends, and then Supreme Court appoints, except only for Supreme Court justices who are vetted by the administration. No? In South Africa, the membership, well, Chief Justice, President, Court of Appeals, again, you will note, Kenya, the membership of the council is filled up by judges, by jurists. No? Qualification. Out of the 6 members from the National Assembly, there is a mixture insofar as South Africa is concerned. No? What's the authority? What can they do? What can the council do? The members in South Africa, which has a large membership of the council, the authority is for regular courts. The president is the final authority and only needs to consult the commission. But there is a constitutional court in South Africa. For the constitutional court, the commission is required to submit a list. In Kenya, the commission recommends the president. The president has no discretion, and the authority is merely ceremonial. For Supreme Court, however, this must be concurred by National Assembly. So here again, there is another situation, and in actual practice, where the appointments of lower courts, lower judges, the appointments are given to the council. It's only the Supreme Court where the authority is to be here, National Assembly, or the president, if the case may be. As I said, in Korea, the council has no appointing of power. It is the Supreme Court, Chief Justice, who appoints all lower court judges. Now, as to term, Kenya says 5 years. Maybe they're elected once, but with respect to the Chief Justice and Attorney General, they are co-terminous positions. No? Thailand, Indonesia, and India. Just to highlight the fact that in India, we have a very, very active Supreme Court. There have been 3 cases in India where the legislative and the judiciary clashed. No? But right now, it is the collegium in India that prevails. It is the one that vets, selects, and appoints judges and even members of the Supreme Court, except only for the Chief Justice. Scope of authority. No? In Thailand, the king appoints judges with the approval of the judicial commission. So the king is merely a ceremonial authority. He appoints, but it's actually the commission that approves. Indonesia, there is a bigger participation of the lower house. No? They intervene actively in the appointments of judicial positions. Now, I just breezed through very, very briefly, but if you have a chance to go through the paper, you'll be able to note many pieces of information, data, if you will, that can help us look at whether or not there is still a need to refine our JVC. But definitely, in my view, there is the position taken by some that it must be abolished is rather a step in the wrong direction. We have never accomplished much by in terms of the what we have now, the JVC, except that we have to keep a pace with what has been happening in the rest of the international community. And I would not want now to make prescriptions or recommendations. I leave it to the reactors to react, whether violently or otherwise. No? We will let them do the reaction. Except that to highlight the favorite term of many speakers, the key takeaway points. I'll call it key points to consider. One, the emerging situation amongst a number of states reflect a discernible departure from executive and legislative dominance. The trend seems to be towards a diminished participation in the judicial appointments process by these two political organs of government. That is the trend that we have seen. An appointment process, number two, that is based on objective criteria, efficient, transparent, and free from executive and legislative dominance, leads to a co-equally independent judiciary, and ultimately to a strong rule of law. Number three, to strengthen the non-ex officio members' decisional independence. We are now talking about the JVC. No? We have four non-ex officio members. To strengthen their independence, it would be ideal to remove their selection and appointment from the traditional political processes and practices. And for this purpose, they should be elected by their peers, as we have seen in the other jurisdictions. But that will require an amendment to the Constitution. Now, four, it is also important to prescribe qualifications and standards for each member of the council, especially for those whom we refer to as non-ex officio members, no? Especially for non-judge members, to further guarantee their competence and independence. Next one, number five, if the possibility of reappointment or gaining a new appointment is taken out of the equation, that's with respect to the members of the council, there will be less incentive for the members to please or appease the appointing or selecting authority, as the case may be, if they will be selected by the sector. No? Just one term is the ideal. Next, to ensure the independence of the JBC and its members, the president, well, this is now aspirational, of course, the president can resolve, without amending the constitution, can restrain himself and can resolve to limit the service of its appointees, of the non-exclusion appointees, members, to one term only, and restrain itself from dangling the proverbial carrot, so to speak, by resolving not to extend any other appointments to public office to a member once the term of office is completed. It may be argued, what if we are all human beings? We feel that at 75, we're still very active and alive and competent. You want to get reappointed. That's very human. So long as there is no prohibition in the Constitution, nothing we can do. The president likes the member to be reappointed. Nothing wrong about it. But the better practice is to have a limit of as to the term, 4 years, 5 years, or 6 years. No reappointment so that the member will be unfettered, will be more independent. Yes, he's not looking to any other appointment. He can be reappointed perhaps by the next administration if he's appointed at a young age. No? Six, a significant judicial reform measure which would require constitutional amendment pertains to the felt need to further judicial independence by empowering the judiciary to select and appoint its members. particularly justices of the appellate courts and trial judges, first and level courts, as we have seen in other jurisdictions. The appointments of lower court judges is given to the council or an independent body, the judiciary actually, the chief judge in some instances. Finally, given the more than 30 years since the JBC was conceptualized in the 1987 Constitution, it may be well nigh to revisit purposely and more in depth the purposes of its purpose, the organizational structure, the composition, and operational linkages with the other branches of government, with the legislative, executive, and judicial. No? Is there a need to divorce it from Supreme Court supervision to make it really independent? That's one that should be looked into also. No? Then, with that kind of a process, we hope to have a much improved and better process of appointing members to judicial posts. One that is unfettered, based on objective criteria, efficient and transparent, to achieve the democratic ideal of a co-independent judiciary, and ultimately a robust rule of law. I end with that, Your Honors, and have I exceeded the time limit, within the time limit? And I would like to take this opportunity, and I would like to believe that I have been able to fill the unforgiving minute with 60 seconds worth of distance run. Thank you very much for listening to me.
Thank you very much for Justice Bruselas for the very informative, very well-researched presentation. His paper is actually 81 pages long, and it's full of footnotes and citations. So we are very fortunate today to have two distinguished gentlemen who will give their reactions to Justice Bruselas' presentation. Each of our reactors will have 15 minutes to give their reaction. Our first reactor is the Dean of the University of the Philippines College of Law, Dean Edgardo Carlo L. Bistan II. Dean Edgardo Bistan graduated from the UP College of Law cum laude and was class valedictorian in 2003. His pre-law course was BS Bachelor of Science in Molecular Biology and Biotechnology, also in UP, and he graduated cum laude also in that course. So as a working student during his law school days, he worked as a court legal researcher and acting branch clerk of court in the Regional Trial Court of Quezon City, Branch 227. And as a young practitioner, he joined the faculty of the Angeles University Foundation School of Law when it was founded in 2006. And since then, he has been teaching law. After joining the ranks of the UP College of Law's regular members of the faculty in 2015, and with the support from UP, he completed his Master of Laws or the LLM program at the Yale Law School in the United States in 2017. Currently, he is in the process of completing his dissertation for Doctor of the Science of Law, JSD, degree, also with the Yale Law School. Let us all welcome Dean Bistan. Dean.
Thank you very much, Justice Kim Posale, for that kind introduction. Good morning, Your Honors, ladies and gentlemen. I hope you would allow me to skip the usual formal salutations and proceed with my reaction. First of all, allow me to congratulate Justice Paul Bruselas for a very well-researched and written paper, and as we all saw earlier, for a very efficient distillation of his 81-page article. And as in the words of Rudyard Kipling, you indeed will be unforgiving minute. I hope, Justice Bruselas, that your paper gets published soon so that our law students and the rest of the legal community could have material that gives the reader an abundance of information on how other jurisdictions structure their institutions and processes for the appointment of members of the judiciary. As I was telling Justice Bruselas earlier, the first part of your paper, the first about 60, 70 pages could be an article in itself. And your recommendations, your discussion of our situation in the country could be a separate paper altogether. But I think the approach he adopted helps to further demystify or helps to further place our Judicial and Bar Council or JBC in context as this institution is situated among its counterparts in other countries. I understand, or I take it, that a very useful comparative survey of institutions and practices, you just saw actually a glimpse of it in Justice Bruselas' presentation. There's a lot more content actually in his paper. But this is done to eventually make the point, I believe, that the country's current choice of having a judicial council like the JBC administering the selection process conforms with the prevalent, if not best practice, on the selection and appointment of members of the judiciary. The country's seemingly wise choice of institutional model notwithstanding, recommendations are then made on how the country's current system for selecting potential appointees to the judiciary could still be improved based on internationally common standards and trends. Politicization and the use of improper considerations for selecting among candidates for judicial posts are identified as the principal risks or faults of our current judicial council approach to the selection of prospective members of the judiciary. Structural changes are recommended that would increase the membership of the JBC and make the selection of its members less dependent on the appointing president, so as to lessen their political, political debt. Alongside these structural changes, behavioral changes are also recommended. Let me repeat that. Behavioral changes are also recommended, especially on the part of the political actors. It is from the fact that these behavioral changes are suggested by Justice Bruselas that I wish to take off from and develop the main points of my reaction. I have to admit that I was a bit stunned or surprised when I saw the paper suggesting, for example, that the powerful office of the presidency defer or desist from influencing the work of the JBC. This unexpected departure from the lengthy technical discussion that the reader that you will encounter when you read the paper caught me at least off guard and would initially seem out of place, even unrealistic or out of rhythm. On the other hand, it does align, I believe, with the author's view about the suitability in large part of the JBC or the Judicial Council model for the important task of assessing and recommending possible appointees to judicial positions. While the author proposes some changes in the composition of the JBC and how those to become members of the JBC are to be appointed, these are relatively minor changes compared, for example, with the decision years ago to create the JBC in the first place, to replace entirely the previous process or mechanism dominated by the executive and legislative branches. If we already have a good enough legal and structural framework, a mechanism for the selection of appointees to judicial posts, and we still perceive shortcomings or faults in its working and output, then we are left with the usual culprit, the human factor or element, the human condition, if you will, described in the paper through the words politicization and improper considerations in the selection of judicial appointees. This human element in the system can only be addressed to a limited extent by institutional design. No matter how good your tool or system is, it can only perform as well as the people using it. This reality is recognized in the paper when our esteemed author recommends the need for behavioral changes on the part of the important actors in the judicial appointment process. Of course, these changes are easier said than done because these require changes in our culture and politics. And in a cynical society, such proposals would be described or relegated to unrealistic wishful thinking. However, I do believe that the paper hits the nail or the real problem on its head in pointing out what really has to happen so that we could achieve the changes we desire in the matter of appointments to the judiciary. To be clear, the solution is not to unrealistically remove any form of politics in the judicial appointment process. I actually believe that any process that is vested with public interest is inherently political. In the context of appointments to the judiciary, the key is to minimize the improper practices or considerations so that competence and ethical moorings become the primary considerations in judicial appointments, and so that full transparency becomes a large part of the work ethic of the JBC. The changes in our culture and political practices that must happen should at the very least insulate the judiciary and our judicial appointment process from the patronage politics, influence peddling, and rent-seeking that is prevalent in our society. These social ills that I just mentioned are pervasive. One need not be a president, a senator, a congressman, or a public official to engage in these practices. As many in the business and even legal community, sad to say, resort to these practices that have been perceived as a way of life even by those from other countries. No? They perceive it as a way of life in the Philippines. This is the reason why I am afraid that the political influence exerted on the judiciary and the judicial appointment process that is lamented in the paper will not be easily addressed by any of the proposed structural and functional changes in the institution of the JBC. This is not to say, of course, that adjustments are not needed or welcome. The point I'm trying to emphasize is that unless the necessary cultural changes materialize somehow, the benefits of positive outcome, the benefits or positive outcomes of reforms would likely be minimal and short-lived. It is in this context that I wish to share a few more thoughts on the suggestion of vesting appointments to the appellate courts and judges of the first and second level courts in the Chief Justice so that the judiciary will be empowered to select and appoint its members. This is one particular suggestion made towards the end of the paper. While I believe this is acceptable, this should be done so that we are not just transferring the target of politics from the president to the Chief Justice. With our present politics and culture, a highly politicized Chief Justice is a very distinct possibility should this proposal materialize. And we should be worried about this, as this could have repercussions that spill over from judicial appointments to the very workings of the Supreme Court. One way to address this perhaps is to make the recommendations of the JBC binding on the Chief Justice, subject to a very narrow set of grounds for disregarding the rankings given by the JBC, a proposal that is also made in the paper elsewhere, but for the appointments to be made by the president. One big design question, however, should certain appointments to judicial posts be vested in the Chief Justice, is the matter of where to appeal or question such appointments. I believe it would be unwise to make such recourse to make such appeals or recourse before the Supreme Court. We should avoid the unwanted spectacle of other justices of the Supreme Court passing upon the Chief Justice's actions, a potential source of awkwardness and embarrassment among those comprising the Supreme Court. This role could probably be assigned to either another branch of government or another entity comprised of representatives from the executive and the legislative branches, and the decision at this level could then be made final and without further recourse. With that, I conclude my reaction to this timely and very welcome piece or article of Justice Bruselas. I wish to thank the Supreme Court, the Philippine Judicial Academy, and the Metrobank Foundation, of course, and of course, our author, the man of the art, Justice Bruselas, for inviting me to be a reactor for this morning's professorial chair lecture. Maraming salamat po.
Thank you very much, Dean Bistan. At this point, let us welcome the next reactor, Attorney Antonio C. Pido. Attorney Antonio Pido graduated from the University of the Philippines College of Law in 1982, where he was a member of the Order of the Purple Feather Honor Society. He has extensive experience in labor law, telecommunications law, criminal, civil, and administrative litigation, and also in alternative dispute resolution. He became an executive labor arbiter of the National Labor Relations Commission from 1986 to 1991, where he, at the same time, gave numerous lectures in labor education seminars and also assisted the NLRC in drafting its own rules and regulations. Currently, Attorney Pido is the executive vice president of the Integrated Bar of the Philippines. Let us welcome Attorney Antonio Pido.
How much time do I have? Honorable Chief Justice Alex Gismundo and the other members of the court, Justice Carandang of the Philippine Judicial Academy, Presiding Justice Fernando of the Court of Appeals, Presiding Justice of the Court of Tax Appeals, to my classmate in law school, Justice Bruselas, and to the Dean of my alma mater, Dean Bistan. Magandang umaga, and to all the guests, especially Metrobank Foundation officers, magandang umaga po sa inyong lahat. First of all, I would like to thank my classmate, Justice Bruselas, for giving me this rare opportunity to be a reactor to his lecture here today in the in-bank session hall of the Supreme Court. It is my first time to speak before this August chamber in my 39 years as a lawyer. And listening to Justice Bruselas today reminds me of the comment of his favorite professor in the College of Law, Justice Crisolito Pascual, who would often tell him, "Mr. Bruselas, please speak slowly." The comment still applies until today, as I observe. Now, his 81-page lecture is indeed well-researched. It speaks volumes of the time and effort he spent scouring over the existing practices all over the world, from Europe, North America, Africa, and Asia. But he told me that he only based his lecture on what he read. Maybe the Metrobank Foundation should give him a chance to travel around these countries and see for himself how this has actually affected the judicial systems in those countries. And by the time he returns, he will give us a better view from the theoretical to the practical. I hope the Metrobank Foundation will listen to my recommendation to allow Justice Bruselas to travel around the world. You know, 81 pages, and at the end of his lecture, he says, it may be well to review the purpose, organizational structure, composition, and operational linkages of the Judicial and Bar Council, with the end in view of having a much improved and better process in appointments to the judiciary. This phrase admits that the process now is good, but he just wants to make it better. Now, review of the judicial of the JBC's purpose. Of course, he stopped there. He admitted it. He said, let the reactors react violently. I do not know what he meant by that. Maybe because he is aware that any attempt to change the purpose, organization, and structure, and composition of the JBC right now will require a constitutional amendment. And of course, he is very much aware how difficult it is to amend the 1987 Constitution. So with that, allow me to give just two basic reactions. Number one, under the 1987 Constitution, the power to appoint justices and judges is an executive function, belongs to the president. We have yet to see a president who would be willing to exercise only formal or ceremonial powers in the appointment of justices and judges, as subliminally suggested by my classmate Justice Brussel. Why? Because it is normal for a president to take steps to ensure that his political agenda is supported by the courts. Even in the USA, which is recognized as one of the most advanced democracies, their immediate past president appointed to the Supreme Court those who shared his conservative views. That is why Roe versus Wade was overturned. I am not saying that it is impossible for an amendment to happen. But maybe if the entire legal community, composed of lawyers in the private sector and in government, in the judiciary, in the legislative, and the executive branch, will act as one and make its singular voice heard, then maybe the concept of ceremonial powers will be seriously considered by the President of the Philippines, either through a legislative enactment or maybe just a memorandum of agreement with the Judicial and Bar Council. But short of any amendment to the Constitution, I respectfully submit that there are still ways to make the system better, which is the desire of my classmate Justice Bruselas. First, in the appointment process of members of the Judicial and Bar Council, we observe that there are 7 members chaired by the Honorable Chief Justice. Only one is not appointed by the President, and that is the member of Congress. 6 out of 7 are appointed by the President. That speaks volumes. We Filipinos have to recognize that it is part of our culture to be thankful, this debt of gratitude. But I believe right now, our crop of justices and judges have already matured enough to set limits to the so-called debt of gratitude. And I hope that continues. I hope that continues. Now, how do we make the system better? There is no law right now on how the regular members of the JBC shall be appointed. All of a sudden, somebody is appointed representing the Integrated Bar of the Philippines. May representative na pala kami. Okay. Luckily enough, Judge De Monteverde, who is now the representative of the IBP, is very mindful of his role as representing the Integrated Bar of the Philippines. So he regularly consults us. But we cannot be sure that all the appointees will be like Justice De Monteverde. So I respectfully submit that the JBC should recommend to the executive branch that a short list should be required from each sector, Integrated Bar, the academe, like Dean Bistan, the private sector and even the retired justices, they should be requested to submit a short list of those who will be appointed to this as regular members of the JBC. So that these sectors will have an opportunity to select from among themselves who they believe will ably represent the interests of that sector and ably explain and defend the recommendations of their sector. That would be a step in the right direction. There is no law, there is no constitutional prohibition on suggesting the submission of a short list of those who will be appointed as regular members of the JBC. I hope the JBC will seriously consider that. You know, the wife of the sitting president is a lawyer, so I am sure she will appreciate the wisdom of having a short list submitted to her husband for appointment for as regular members of the JBC. Another thing on how the workings of the JBC can be improved. May I invite your attention to the mandatory constitutional qualifications for appointment to the judiciary in relation to the work of the JBC. Subparagraph 3, Section 7 of Article 8 says, a member of the judiciary must be a person of proven competence, integrity, probity, and independence. I wish to put emphasis on this constitutional word, proven. Here, regarding the qualities of a member of the judiciary, I submit that this gives the JBC sufficient authority to conduct an in-depth investigation into the competence, integrity, probity, and independence of each and every judicial applicant. Okay? And only those who are proven to possess these qualities should be recommended by the JBC. I submit that the JBC has enough powers to promulgate its own rules to determine the quantum of evidence required so that an applicant can be considered to have proven himself or herself as possessing these four qualities. Of course, there is already jurisprudence to the effect that the work of the JBC is under the supervision and subject to the corrections of the Supreme Court. Sereno ruling. So no problem that the JBC will abuse its authority. Now, the JBC should conduct investigation into the personal, academic, and professional backgrounds of the applicant. To paraphrase the favorite professor of Justice Bruselas, Justice Crisolito Pascual, you can inquire into the applicant's opinions, beliefs, longings, idiosyncrasies, and even superstitions, because this will affect the judge's decision in the ultimate analysis. If necessary, why not require the applicant to sign a waiver of the data privacy law or even the bank secrecy law? Now, all these things taken together can be the basis of the JBC to arrive at the conclusion that the applicant has proven himself as competent with integrity, probity, and independence that makes the applicant qualified to become a justice or a judge. Only those applicants who the JBC feels have proven himself or herself to possess these qualities should be included in the shortlist recommended to the president. The JBC, may I say, should be active in this investigation process. What is now prevalent in the executive branch can even be borrowed by the JBC, meaning to say the JBC can also request for its confidential funds when it presents to Congress its proposed budget so that it can properly investigate this applicant. So those are my two major reactions to the paper of my good classmate Justice Bruselas. But at the end of the day, I submit that regardless of whether or not the present constitution is amended, whether or not there is a memorandum of agreement with the president regarding having ceremonial or formal powers of appointment, there will always be some human factor in the appointments process. So what we should seek to avoid is to have an executive, an appointing authority who is heavily influenced by his or her own personal interest and does not have the welfare of the nation in mind. Maraming salamat po, Justice.
Thank you very much, Attorney Pido. We thank our esteemed lecturer, Justice Apolinario Bruselas, and our distinguished three actors, Edine Bistan and Attorney Pido, for sharing their insights this morning. The next part of the program is our open forum. And meanwhile, on the screen, for those who are participating online, is a QR code and a link to an online form where questions can be typed. For our on-site participants, there is an additional option of writing your questions on a small sheet of paper included in your program. And kindly hand them over to the secretariat or the ushers for your questions. And for those who prefer to ask the questions personally, there are microphones available on site. But please kindly share your name and your office before asking the question. So meanwhile, may we please request Chief Power Justice, Justice Bruselas, Dean Bistan, and Attorney Pido to please come forward and stay on stage for the open forum, please. Okay, so any question? Okay, there is one question po from Attorney Romino Arzadon of the Supreme Court. There have been proposals already to change the appointment process. What is the advantage of your proposal that it might come to fruition? This is addressed to Attorney Arzadon. May I know this question is addressed to whom? To Justice Bruselas? Okay, Justice Bruselas po.
Are we referring to the previously filed bills in Congress concerning the JBC? Is that the meat of the question? Or are we referring to the general comments, observations from the public concerning the processes followed by the JBC? Because I am not sure as to what proposals are being referred to change the process. So far, what I know is that the comment that I heard, that I mentioned about earlier of Solicitor General Mendoza before, no? That he would rather return to the 35 Constitution, meaning to say the President appoints and Congress consents or concurs in the appointment. And then the other one is the proposal of Chief Justice Puno about replacing JBC with the judicial appointments and disciplinary council, integrating the JIB functions now, no? In discipline and of course selection and recruitment. If those are the proposals that you have in mind, then my reaction is this. The proposals that I have, actually that there are no proposals, I just have an itemization of points to consider in having a more in-depth study of our own JBC vis-a-vis the practices in the international community. For instance, what my friend Justice Attorney Pido said, it is difficult considering our culture, our social milieu, for a departure from the present setup of the appointing authority being the executive appointing judges. Difficult indeed. But as we have seen, there is merit in having a dichotomy where you have trial judges, local judges being appointed by the judiciary itself, by its own process, and leave up, leave it up to the president and executive to take care of the Supreme Court appointments. That's one proposal. Is that better? As far as we're concerned, there is no experience, but the other countries, they have that experience, and it seems to be working well. So that's what I can say to this question of attorney from the Supreme Court.
So thank you, Justice Brusela. There is another question here from Dean Pamaran of the Office of Associate Justice Mario Lopez. How will you describe the level and status of Filipino consciousness about judicial appointment? Second question, what do you think is a better counter consciousness? So the first question is, how will you describe the level and status of Filipino consciousness about judicial appointment? May I know who is, to whom is this question addressed to? Dean Pamaran, sir? So I suppose it will be up to Justice
Precisely, Christian. The study's purpose is to awaken the consciousness. That's the purpose of the study, to awaken the consciousness of our populace. That's the answer to the question, how to awaken. The other one is?
What do you think is a better counter-consciousness?
Better counter consciousness. The more we think about the process, the more we become aware. That's how we are able to develop a better consciousness, not a counter consciousness. Because we are not saying that we are totally divorced of what's happening. We are aware, except that our present social, cultural, political milieu sort of blinds us from looking at it from a better angle. So, to be able to develop a better consciousness, we talk about it. This study is precisely meant to initiate, to titillate the minds, our minds. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you, Paul. Any other question? Okay, yes, Paul.
I'd like to ask a question to Justice Paul,
yes, sir.
My immediate predecessor at the QCRTC Branch 93.
Apo.
Congratulations, first of all, Justice Paul, for a very well research article. Ang gusto ko lang pong itanong, can you see a post-appointment role for the JBC when it comes to disciplinary issues concerning appointed officials to the bench? Of course, we already have the JIB, but JBC has a pre-appointment role only, no? And as we all know, SC has the power to, that supervisory power over the JBC, and can therefore extend to it some other roles aside from pre-appointment duties. No? So perhaps, what I'm driving at, baka maigi rin na yung JBC bigyan ng role sa point of post-appointment process, complementary to the JIB.
Tama po yun. Very well said po, Justice Bon. Precisely, yun ang din ni Chief Justice Buno in advocating for a judiciary appointments and disciplinary council. And that is not something new, because in other jurisdictions, they call it the Judicial Service Commission, which takes care of selection, recruitment, appointment, and also at the other end, possible termination, dismissal. In other words, disciplinary functions also. So my answer to Justice Mamon Hernando is yes, sir. Pwede po yung magkaroon. We can envision such a body, but it has to be independent. It has to be independent of the legislative, executive, and judicial. Siya na talaga. That is another model. Right now, our JBC is primarily tasked with, yes, recruitment, selection, and recommendatory powers only. That's the JIB. And under the supervision of the Supreme Court, I think there is something there that we should look at. Should it be allowed to continue as later on, no? As we look at further, is it better to have a judicial council or judicial commission that is totally divorced from executive, legislative, and judicial connections? Meaning to say, have a separate budget for them, have a separate structure for them. Much like the Civil Service Commission, the COA, and the Commission on Elections, like sort of like that. So in other words, divorce, yeah, and do not burden the Supreme Court with other duties of supervising JBC. I mean, just a model. Yung po, sagot ko, Justice Mon, na pwede po yun, na that is separate, not as still under the supervision of the Supreme Court, because magdodoble po yung mechanism for disciplining Supreme Court pa, mahirapan po yung Supreme Court. Pwede separate, ano siya, separate entity. But it will require a constitutional amendment po.
Okay. Thank you for that question, Justice Fernando. Thank you for the answers. For any answer, for any other question, please. None. No more online. How about online? Do we still have other questions online?
Meron daw yatang, I just heard that we intend to share plans to those online. And they have to turn off their privacy features para malaman yung kanilang geographical locations. And secondly, mukhang di papayag ang NPC to do that. Yeah, they will have to bring it to the NPC to allow us to look at their locations. So we can serve them lunch.
How about divulging your location when asking the question? No? None? I have a question to Dean Bistan. You said you mentioned something about behavior that should be considered also. Behavior of the applicants. And it...
No, Justice. It's more about, I suppose, the behavior of everyone interested in the work of the JBC. Meaning, because in the paper, a large part of what Justice Bruselas was pinpointing as a major problem is the politics, the influence that... various sectors, the executive primarily also, is trying to exert on the JBC. So what I was mentioning then there was that whatever system we have, even if we improve it, if that remains to be how we are, or how our community is, how our lawyers, our businessmen, or anyone interested in the judiciary would act. Or would they would still try to influence the system, then as I said earlier, the benefits of any reform would be minimal and maybe just short-lived. So there has to be, but I hope to be in a realistic and not too optimistic way. I think that starts with our leaders. Attorney Pido also said something to that effect, no? It's in the ethos or ethics of our leaders. It has to start with them. We try to say, for example, let's not really we try to look at the president primarily as the executive, but he also has a lot of people around him. When we say the president, sometimes we actually refer to Malacañang and those working with him, and they sometimes act on their own. To do things. So that, I think, is what has to change if we are to really reap full benefit from any reform in any institution for that matter. Yun lang po. Yun po yung ibig ko sabihin by the culture or behavior, na behavioral changes that have to happen. So I think ang maganda lang po kasi sa judiciary, there's that concept of independence talaga. No, ng judiciary, and that's a good thing. I think the members of the judiciary, the courts, can invoke that anytime against any attempts to influence its work. Yun po. Thank you very much.
Thank you for the clarification. And Attorney Pido, I also have a question. You are the executive vice president of the IPP, right? So for any representative from the IPP should be consulted directly. Representative to the JBC, which has not happened in the past.
Is it naman.
True?
The Integrated Bar is the official organization of lawyers, compulsory in character. So I submit that with this provision in this JBC, which provides that there should be a representative from the Integrated Bar.
it is important that the IBP is consulted as to who will be its representative in the JBC. In fact, the Honorable Chief Justice Guismundo has already told us that as far as applicants to the first and second levels, level courts are concerned, the Chief Justice feels that the IBP chapters where the applicant belongs should be consulted because they know these people more, especially if they have interacted with the applicant for several years already in the chapter. So they know his character, they know his background. So for that reason, the Chief Justice told us it is important that your chapters be consulted insofar as first and second level court applicants are concerned. And for that, we are thankful to the Chief Justice.
Thank you very much, Attorney Pido, for that update and for that clarification and the update regarding the communication with the Chief Justice with the IBP. Okay, so now we go to the next part of our program. Thank you very much po for all your questions online and on-site. Thank you very much po. And thank you also Justice Bruselas, Dean Vistan, and Attorney Pido. Thank you po. A big round of applause for them, please. And now we go to the next part of the program, the intermission number by the Supreme Court Choir. Please. Thank you very much, Supreme Court Choir, for that riveting performance. We now proceed to the presentation of the paper to the Supreme Court and Metrobank Foundation. May we please call on Chief Justice Alexander Hesmundo, Chancellor Carandang, Mr. Sobrepeña, and Justice Bruselas. Carandang, shareholder, the paper may now be presented to the Metrobank Foundation. Please, Your Honor. Okay. Now, Mr. Sobrepeña, at this point, the paper may now be presented to the Honorable Chief Justice. And now we shall have the presentation of the endowment to the shareholder. Presentation of endowment to the shareholder by the Metrobank Foundation Incorporated. Next, we shall have the presentation of plaques of appreciation to the Metrobank Foundation, the shareholder, as well as our two reactors. Dean Vistan and Attorney Pido, please come on stage. Let's start first with the presentation of the plaque of appreciation to Metrobank Foundation to be presented by Chief Justice Hesmundo. Okay, the citation reads, Republic of the Philippines, Supreme Court, Philippine Judicial Academy present this testament of gratitude to Metrobank Foundation Incorporated for having contributed significantly to the enhancement of judicial education. Metrobank Foundation's endorsement has allowed the members of the Philippine judiciary to benefit from the scholarly research and presentation of the holder of the 18th Metrobank Foundation Professorial Chair, Justice Apolinario D. Bruselas, Jr., who wrote Revisiting the Appointment Process to Philippine Judicial Posts, Models and Standards, Practices in Some States, delivered at the 18th Metrobank Foundation Professorial Chair Lecture on the 24th of November at the Supreme Court en banc session hall. We express our gratitude and acknowledge the contribution of Metrobank Foundation Incorporated to the success of this project. Given this 24th day of November 2022 at the Supreme Court en banc session hall, Supreme Court New Building, Manila, Philippines. Signed, Honorable Alexander G. Hesmundo, Chief Justice. Signed, Honorable Rosemary D. Carandang, Chancellor. Now we shall present a plaque of appreciation to the shareholder, Justice Bruselas. Chief Justice will present. Okay, it reads, Republic of the Philippines, Supreme Court, Philippine Judicial Academy, academic recognition to Honorable Apolinario D. Bruselas, Jr., for the presentation and successful delivery of his paper on Revisiting the Appointment Process to Philippine Judicial Posts, Models and Standards, Practices in Some States, given at the 18th Metrobank Foundation Professorial Chair Lecture, which the Philippine Judicial Academy co-sponsors with Metrobank Foundation as part of the continuing development and enhancement of its programs in judicial education, the encouragement of scholarly work on innovative concepts and approaches in designated areas of law, and the promotion of competence, excellence, and efficiency in the Philippine justice system. Given this 24th day of November 2022 at the Supreme Court En Banc Session Hall, Supreme Court New Building, Manila, Philippines. Signed, Honorable Alexander G. Hesmundo, Chief Justice. Signed, Honorable Rosemary D. Carandang, Chancellor. Now, let us present a plaque of appreciation to the reactors, Dean Vistan and Attorney Pido. Okay. Okay. Dean Vistan from the Chief Justice. The citation is the same as what was stated earlier in the plaque given to Justice Rosellas. Thank you po. The next one is Attorney Pido. Please come forward to receive your plaque from the Chief Justice and the Chancellor. The citation is also the same as what was read earlier. Everyone will have a photo shoot. Everyone, please. The Chief Justice in the center with Justice Bruselas. Thank you very much, po. So now to give the closing remarks, please welcome the Chief Justice of the Philippines, Honorable Alexander G. Hesmundo.
Please be seated. After hearing the lecture and the reactions and the questions during the open forum, I thought I should not say anything more. The conclusion is that there are things that need to be addressed as far as the judicial selection process. Of judicial appointments. I commend Court of Appeals Associate Justice Apolinario D. Bruselas Jr. for his incisive research on the process of appointments to judicial posts. Some of his innovative suggestions may be feasible, but they may require constitutional amendments or are better addressed to the sound judgment of the elected officials concerned. As to the revisiting our decisions, in cases he mentioned involving the JBC, the opportunity has not presented itself. But even then, I may not be able to commit how the court would dispose of the matter. With regard to the fiscal autonomy of the JBC mentioned in his treatise, a separate item for its budget is already included in the GAA. So its budget is not totally dependent on the Supreme Court. But the matter of appointments to judicial posts incipiently hinges on the JBC, and the shortlisting of nominees is exclusively dependent on the personal assessment of candidates by each individual member. When these members cast their votes for a candidate, we can only presume
that they did what was mandated to them under the Constitution, and that they were guided by their conscience and patriotism, taking into account what was needed to be considered, regardless of political pressure or influence, should there have been any. The essential qualifications for being a member of the judiciary have been constitutionally provided in determining the individuals most qualified to serve the court is neither easy or pleasant. The search for the best candidates with proven competence, integrity, probity, and independence is truly a judgment call, but based on facts as set forth in the personal data sheet and other documents to be submitted by the applicants for the position. As I have said before, the members of the JBC have always been up to the task, and we have the JBC to thank for the present members of the judiciary. The reality now is that much we want or desire to introduce innovations and changes in the judiciary position, selection. As mentioned by Justice Bruselas and the reactors, we are constrained by the constitutional limitations. If you read the Constitution on the provisions on the JBC, unlike most of the provisions in the Constitution, where it always ends with a collatilia, as may be provided by law, the provisions on JBC as the body to select the members of the judiciary did not have that provision. Perhaps the intention of the framers is to disengage the legislature in the process of selection, save for the members designated in the same provisions. Had it been the case, I think Congress could have possibly made legislations that specifies the qualifications of the members of the JBC, or even the mandatory requirements that the members, other than those ex-officio members, must be fully endorsed by the peers that they are supposed to represent in the council. But that is the reality before us, the lack of the power of Congress to legislate on those specific issues concerning the JBC. In closing, let me extend my thanks to PILJA for holding this activity. My thanks to Chito Sobrepeña and the Metrobank Foundation for its continued support to our judiciary initiatives and reforms. You earlier mentioned how the Supreme Court that earlier launched the SPJI and the poll survey ratings about the performance of the court. But let me tell everyone, whatever achievements or what we are doing, the credit doesn't belong to me. It belongs to the 15 members of the court and bank and every official employee of the Supreme Court and the judiciary. Thank you very much and good afternoon.
Thank you very much for Honorable Chief Justice Hesmundo. The official announcement by Umalahokan. Okay, so this ends our program for today. Thank you all for joining us this morning on site and online. But before we leave, please fill out the evaluation forms distributed earlier and kindly submit them there at the Secretariat's table. And we shall have the audiovisual presentation of the Philippine Judiciary Hymn. But as Chief Justice said,
or our officials today are invited for lunch. So thank you very much po, Chief Justice Edmundo, the Justices, Mr. Sobrepeña, Justice Bruselas, and everyone po. Have a wonderful day po. Thank you.